Aí dá de carinho. Find the book. Then we conceptualize. This was a brainstorming thought. Then we analyze. Then we evaluate a prototype. Communicate the results and finally we build a product. That's our design protocol. This is how we do it every time. Okay? We have talked through most of this the last time around. We pretty much stopped at talking about communicating. So I'm going to go back to that. I think I ended the last class by reminding you or telling you of how the system actually works. So most of you are going to be in relatively large companies. Relatively meaning, so if you look at the size of companies, I'll define them as small is 10 people or less, medium is in the 100, and large is in the 1,000 people. Okay? So in small companies, if you're the engineer, you're probably the engineer. If it's a 100-person company, then you end up with a mix. 100-person companies come in all kinds of shapes. It's really hard to say anything general about those companies. 1,000-people companies get stratified very quickly. They separate them out into sales and marketing and management and technical things and design. And the engineers typically in design or in sales. Typically, the engineer from design and sales in 7 years moves up into management. The average half-life of an engineer in this country is 7 years. In 7 years, you will move out of being only a designer or only an engineer to also having responsibility for people. That's just the nature of things. So typically, a manager has some idea of what you do. But in any case, the way design things usually work is somebody in sales says, we have a problem, we need to solve it. That idea gets filtered up. You define the problem, then you conceptualize, you do all of that. Finally, now you've got a design, you evaluate your prototype, you take that design back to the managers and you say, I've got a good design here, this is what we should build. We're going from whatever the investment was in the prototype to whatever the investment is needed now to buy all this material instead of making one of them to make 100,000. So that's a big decision. So this is the communication part. So typically, let's write this down. Typically, you're communicating to managers. Let's figure out who we communicate with. Sometimes sales, but typically non-technical people. That's one kind. This might be customers who may be technical, but often are not. Those kinds of presentations are the hardest. You're going to try to translate something that's a technical idea in your head into something that the customer can have. That's usually done by sales. Okay. But if you're trying to communicate what you can do, what you've designed in your head to a manager, now you can be technical because the expectation is over time, this manager has learned to handle the technical issue. Typically, that manager who's making that decision has a technical background. All right. That's communicating to people. But the thing to remember is any communication you make, whether it's a presentation or let's talk about this. What do I mean by communicating? The standard communication, I'm standing here and talking to you. There's the second level of communication, there's a presentation. It might be PowerPoint or something else. I hate PowerPoint. But some presentation tool of some sort, which you then make a presentation to managers. Managers love PowerPoint. Now, at that point, that document that you've created, your PowerPoint document, actually gets moved around and looked at by other people. So the information you put in there is looked at not just by the person you're talking to, but somebody 3 weeks from now, 2 years from now, looks at what's in that PowerPoint. So you've got to be careful about what you put in there. But the next level up is where things get interesting. So I made the pitch, the manager agreed, we're going to make 100,000 of these things, but I'm not going to make 100,000 of these things. The people in manufacturing are going to make 100,000. The people in manufacturing now need to know what I design. So I'm going to give them something that tells them this is what I want you to make. That something is typically in the form of software, right? It might be a solid model, it might be a CAD model, but it's going to be something that's an electronic file that goes through. And the question is, have you given them all the information they need? So let's write this down. What are you going to put down? You might be giving them a CAD model, or a solid model. You'll be providing them with what are called design records. So that becomes a legal document. That design record is actually a legal document that can be used when somebody sues your company. They say, this is what you designed. It has all of the technical information used in your design. If your product gets, let's say, results in someone's death, then that document is what they come back to say, this was the original design process. So this is a legal record. What else do you put in this design presentation? You'll put down the tolerances. So you'll say, I want a 1-inch diameter shaft, but it's 1-inch plus or minus 0.001. So that's what you put in. Now you've got to understand where the design goes. Typically, your design moves downstream in the product process. That is, I'm showing this as I communicate and I go to a product, but there's actually many, many steps here. I communicate, I've got the design, I give it to somebody. It now goes to the manufacturing engineer, the production engineer. The production engineer takes that design, looks at this piece and says, okay, this guy is trying to make a display for the hole in it. That means I need this machine to make the plate and this machine to make the hole. I want 100,000 of these, so here's my process. I can either make 100,000 plates and then make 100,000 holes, or I can make a plate and a hole, the plate and a hole, the plate and a hole, and do that 100,000 times. And I can do that either way. And one is cheaper than the other. Which is cheaper depends on my particular machine shop. In this shop, it might be easier to make 100,000 plates and then we'll make 100,000 holes. In that shop, it might be easier to go plate four, plate four. Okay, so this kind of thing is what gets communicated down. I guess a way to think about it is, as it goes down the line, you lose information. Right? It's the classical question of passing messages down a line. The further down you go, not only are you typically losing some information, but you're losing the person who's looking at it. So if I give it to you directly, you probably know what you're going to get from me, and you tend to read my information a particular way. Three people down, that person is getting it today from X and tomorrow from Y. Gets different kinds of information every time, reads it differently. So the more information you put in a standard format, the better. So if you work for a large company, they will tell you, not only do you do the design, but you have to give me this and this and this and this. And you have to give it to me in this format. You've got to live with it. If you don't do it, you can get sued eventually in the company. So just remember that communication always moves downstream. And typically, technical capability does not move downstream. The person who knows the most about your design is you. And after that, everyone else knows a little bit less. So, all of this information gets saved in databases. Because if I fire you tomorrow, I still don't be able to fire you tomorrow. Questions of intellectual property and so forth, but I will get to that. So let's think about this process in a different sense. Let's identify this as essentially being time. So as you move down this process, you are going later and later in time in your design process. Now all of these things feed back, right? There are lots of feedback loops here. But I'm thinking about the overall time in the system. Let me tell you something that most people will not tell you, because you will either take classes in economics or you will take classes in engineering, and very rarely do you take a class in engineering economics. Well, sometimes you'll see this in an engineering business class. The question is, how does money go with design? How does money go with time in terms of the design process? And here's the plot you need to know. Think about the cost as a function of time
These clocks are like this. Actually, it's much taller.
Point about this is, if you make a change to your concept here, okay, your conceptualization phase, that's down here somewhere. I make a change to small cost. I should really think of this as the cost of a change, rather than total cost. What is the cost of a change to the design? Early on, the cost of a change to the design is very small. Once you get to this stage, takes off. So you don't want people telling you at the last minute, well, you know, we really would like you to have a handle here. That will dramatically inflate the cost. If you look at good product management, you'll see people who come in and say, right in here, when you're setting the problem up, let's bring in all the people who are potential users, get them to look at it, tell us what we need.
Why is it that some companies then, in times when they should make a recall, they seem to wait till like the last possible minute or try to delay?
Sure.
Well, that's a different thing, right? They're not in the design process. They've designed it, they've shipped it, they've set it up. Now, if you think about it, if you're that company, unless you have a really good legal team, well, if you have a really good legal team, you may not worry about it. But if you have a typical legal team, you are going to lose money one way or the other. You're going to minimize how much money you lose in a recall. And it's usually really difficult to decide what that timeline is. So people, if you're a person on the legal side, you'd be looking at a cost like this, and that cost plot of the recall does this. There's a minimum somewhere. If I place the recall at the right time, the fewest people are listening, but I've met my legal liability, I get only these many things coming back, and my damage is minimized. But it's really hard to find that minimum. And so most people end up putting it off as long as they can. Good companies are good at finding those minimum. And usually that minimum is already in the process. Okay, so this is the cost plot. I'm not going to show this to you anymore, but you should think about it as these cost structures typically come here. The big takeoff and the cost is there. So when you get to this point, you usually bring your customer in, you bring the manager in, show it to them the first time before you even make that communication. Because here you can still loop back. Once you get out here, if you want to loop back, it's incredibly expensive. Okay, with that in mind, let's talk about who should be involved in such a team. Let's think of an engineering design team. So somebody from sales, usually, the design engineer. Production engineer, or the manufacturing engineer, somebody from management. So someone who actually thinks about the money. Your shop floor supervisor. If you're going to make a lot of anything, it's going to happen on some kind of a shop floor. There's somebody who runs that shop floor. That's the person who tells you who the plates person that office. You want someone from an industrial design background, or the paperwork background. Some companies call it product design. And then of course you want someone from marketing. Different from sales. So those are the people that you typically want in your design team. So when you guys go out and you start doing your senior design project and so forth, most of you, well, all of you are doing senior design, now remember that somebody's got to play each of those roles. Sometimes your instructor will play the management role, but someone has to think about these. Yeah, good question.
Where does, in terms of the legal member of the team, does that necessarily have to be an engineer or not? Wouldn't that be important?
So usually the management person is looking at the legal side too. If it's something that has significant potential liability, like if you're building a biomedical device, you may have a legal person involved in the legal. But normally you don't. Okay. All right, so that's our basic process on these three boards. We run through this, we look at the communication. I'm not going to talk about communication any more than what I've done today. Some other courses will tackle that. And then we have to have a team like that. So now let's get to the meat of it in here. Right? This is where mechanics state design sits. We've got sort of a word state in the problem, we've got to define a real problem, we've got to conceptualize, then we've got to analyze. That's where we sit. So let's go back in here and see what we can. So what does defining the problem mean? It really means to define the design considerations. So, let's see if that works now. We're going to separate the design considerations into two kinds, technical and non-technical. This is what we call design criteria in the last class. These are the reasons why, the specific things you want to get done. So typical technical considerations are things like the strength. So will it carry the load that you apply? The deflection. Will it change shape too much? Will it bend too much? The lifetime or the endurance. How long will it last? The thermal properties. Does it feel warm? Does it feel cold? Reliability. Which is related to but different from life. So, the idea with reliability is I make 100,000 of these and only 3 of them are likely to fail in 10 years. The idea of life is it's 10 years, not 20. Obviously, things like shape, what it looks like. You might add mass to this. How heavy it feels. Manufacturability. How easily can you make it? This relates to cost. And then a final one that I'm going to write, I'll write here. Can you see what I'm doing here, Gamal?
Yes.
So here's one that's really important. The failure mode. So let's think about this for a minute. I'm going to design something. I typically design it so that it will not fail. That is the idea, right? I'm going to design something so it will not fail. The question though is, if it does fail, how does it fail? So I'm designing so it won't fail. But occasionally, some customer pushes it beyond its limits and it fails. Now does it fail slowly? Does it fail fast? So let's take an example. You guys have all driven behind the tanker trucks on the highway. Massive tankers typically carrying hazardous chemicals. If you look at those trucks, they typically look like they're made of steel. They typically look like they're made of stainless steel, but they're not really stainless steel. They're basically pressure vessels. You stuff as much of the hazardous chemical inside as you can. So now you've got a cylindrical tank or semi-cylindrical tank filled with something at high pressure. If you're driving this thing on the road, you get things thrown up from the road all the time. And they whack into this truck. And sometimes you have people who come by and hammer away. And sometimes your truck is sitting outside for 20 years and it rains on the truck. Eventually, you get a hole in that cylinder. When you get that hole, you have two ways in which you can have this thing fail. You can decide that you want the truck to explode, or you can decide that you want the truck to leak. So let me get a show of hands. How many of you would want it to leak? How many of you would want it to explode? Why?
Hollywood?
Like, he is Hollywood.
Actually, you might want to, depending on the circumstance, especially if it's kind of having this kind of thing, a legal drug could be for God knows how long, losing God knows what into the atmosphere of the road. This explosion, you already know what's going on.
You're exactly right. You would rather know when it fails than not know. That's what you designed. You designed to know when it fails. Now, you may not really want to explode, but you want it to be absolutely obvious when it fails. If the thing is leaking, you will continue to drive it, and you will drive it for your 20 years, and your liability is huge, and the number of people you hurt is much larger. But if you know when it fails, then that's a better thing. On the other hand, if the thing you were designing is exactly the same idea, thin wall pressure vessel, but it was the fuselage of a plane, that's not what you want, right? Then you want it to leak. So depending on what you're doing, you decide what the failure is.
Yes. There's no other way to like determine if it was leaking other than like having it explode. Yeah. I mean, it seems like kind of like, well, I'll just take the risk of the whole thing blowing up so I know it's not
leaking. So obviously we are exaggerating the extremes, but the fact is, most of the time, you do not have the ability to constantly inspect the trucks. I design the truck and I sell the truck. And then the person who's driving the truck is typically somebody who doesn't want that job of driving the truck. And because it's a helpless, and they're not going to drive quite as commonly as you'd like. They're not going to be trained, and they're not going to be watching. Usually, you have to assume that this thing is going to get the worst case. Okay, so we design the variable. This is actually one of the design principles. And you can design it to be slow or fast, depending on the issue. Look at the non-technical sides. So obviously you want to design for safety. Safety might be short-term or long-term. That's the first thing, always. The second thing is cost. The third thing is environmental impacts. The one example we just talked about is the Chinese chemical that has all three. It's a very expensive structure, has massive environmental impact and big safety risks. Societal impact. Quality of life. Examples where quality of life matters, and of course, there's some. So, this is the standard list. Anytime you're building a design problem, you look at this list and you decide what's important to you. And you make sure that those things are hit. Yeah.
Could you consider environmental technical, though? Because
could be. It could be. Yeah. It depends on how much you know about the environment. Sometimes it's really hard to evaluate it technically.
And why is aesthetics technical in this case? I mean, wouldn't it matter really? Wouldn't you really just care more about aesthetics?
So there are some sides to aesthetics that you can go in and measure. So when I say technical, it means you can measure it. You can get a quantitative estimate. Non-technical means sometimes you can measure it, sometimes you can't. But typically, the people who are deciding whether you hit your measure are not. Okay, so if you look at the, let's say, 90% of what you guys will do in mechanical design, you will worry about everything about this. All of these you worry about. The aesthetics, sometimes you don't think about it. You're designing things, right, where you're selling from one business to another business. If you're selling from a business to a consumer, then that becomes a big deal. And then you will always worry about these two. All right, so we have now a set of design considerations. Let's talk about, make a distinction here. So you want to distinguish between two things. There are design considerations and there are engineering specifications. These are two slightly different things. So a design consideration might be design for strength. An engineering specification might be the strength must be 300 MPa. So question, how quantitative do you get? All right, I'm going to take maybe 10 minutes to talk about cost. So there are four rules you use when you're deciding what the cost of the structure is going to be, the cost of the design. The first rule is, I want to make this thing with the lowest initial cost. My cost to make it is as low as possible. The second rule might be, I want the lowest lifetime cost. I don't care so much how much it costs right now. I care about how much it will cost you over the lifetime. This is from the Mac PC difference. The third would be the average rate of return. And this is a hard one for most engineers to get a grasp of, but let's talk about it. It's usually an annual basis. So I can make this thing for you, it'll cost you $100,000. You're going to sell it and you get $120,000. So you make $20,000. But I'm the manager and I'm trying to make my decision. I can give you $100,000 at the end of 5 years and get $20,000. Or I can give somebody else $100,000 and they're going to put it in this really risky stock market and they're going to come back to me with $125,000. Why should I make a profit? I'm in the business of making money. I'll put the money there. That's the annual rate of return. Sometimes you get three different products, and one of them will make you money in 5 years, the other one makes you money in 10 years, the other one makes you money in 20 years. You have to look at how long it takes to make the money. Okay? And how much you can get from each of those. All right, and the last. Is actually what I just said. The payback. These are things you need to think about when you're doing your communications presentation. Right? You're talking to your manager is looking at this stuff. Your manager assumes you know how to do your job. You're going to give the manager a design of work. But your manager worries about this. Okay. And then the last piece to talk about here is safety. And we'll come back to safety 3 or 4 times during the talk. But I've designed it to carry 150 pounds, so I've got a margin of safety. That's sort of the standard way of thinking about safety. The question of risk is not just how safe are you, but if there's a problem, how much risk are you carrying as a company? And the way to think about the magnitude and frequency idea, magnitude is how much will it cost you when it happens. Frequency is how often will it happen. So, suppose I have this particular product I make. Potentially, it can fail in this way, and if it fails in that way, it will cost you $100,000. But that happens only once every 20 years. Here's another failure mode. It can fail in this way, but if it fails in this way, it costs you only $1. But it fails every day. Which is the greater risk? Which one do you want to design against? You multiply those two, that's how you decide. You design against the greater risk. Where you get in trouble is when you have a catastrophic but rare event. The asteroid impact on the Earth. The probability of it happening is near zero, but the consequences of it happening are infinite, right? So the product is not anything you like. So if you get those kinds of conditions, it's really hard to make decisions. But normally in engineering, we can quantify these things. So you will often get asked, how often will something fail? That's the risk measure. All right. And usually you end up balancing risk and cost. So that's always a life course. Okay, So with this in mind, let's talk about design matters. So define the design factor as ND or DF. It's the loss of a function. Some parameter that defines the loss of that function. Divided by the maximum allowable value of that parameter. So, the way you might think about this, here's my bar of material. It has a certain maximum load it can carry. If I put 150 pounds on it, this thing fails. That's the loss of function parameter, it's 150 pounds. Okay? But I designed this thing so that the maximum stress that's allowable in it is 200 pounds. That's my maximum allowable stress. I designed it for 100 pounds. So it would fail at 150 pounds. I designed it to carry no more than 100 pounds. So that the maximum force in it would be no more than 100 pounds. So this is a typical design factor. Now we usually don't use load, we use stress. So typically this would be defined in terms of stress. So classic example is this would be the strength of the material. Over the maximum stress. So I do the tension problem, I calculate my maximum stress to be something. I know the strength of my material, I make sure my strength of my material is at least twice the maximum stress. So maybe I use twice the diameter of the rod so that I can reduce the stress. Okay, the rod is the same material, but it's about the diameter. So that's the design factor. There's a different factor we think about called the safety factor. This distinction is important. This is the same kind of thing that you, let me write it this way, what you get rather than what you design. So what do I mean by this? Let's take the simple tension problem. So I have a ball of steel. I know I'm going to carry a certain load. I decide I have a design factor of 2. That tells me that my bar should be 0.75 inches in diameter. Okay, fine, that's my design. 3/4 inch bar will carry the load.